here, you get a little irritated. 7:30, you're tired. 8 o'clock, you're like upset, right? He rolls in at 8:30. And he's like, hey, you know, why is the steak cold? And you're like, oh no. You know, and you're like going off, you've been thinking about it for an hour and a half, what you're gonna say, and you're like, you know, firing at him all the reasons why he's a, you know, a jerk. But if he comes in and he's like, oh my gosh, you're right. I'm so sorry. I should have called you. It was irresponsible of me to be so late, and you put all this effort in. I apologize. Where do you go from there? You can't really continue with the argument because he just apologized and agreed with you, correct? That's what validating an objection does. He was basically taking it off the table and saying, I agree with you. So, for example, if someone says, I don't have time, I don't have money, I don't know people, I don't care what the objection is, your response is always going to be, I appreciate you sharing that with me. I understand why you feel that way. Or, thank you for bringing that up. Or, thank you for your honest response. Or, I understand why you see it that way. I actually thought that way myself. Something that just says, I get it, I hear you. You guys following me? Okay. The second thing is to neutralize it. Neutralize. So, if someone were to say, I don't have enough time to do this business. And you say, hey, I appreciate your honest response. I understand why you feel that way. So let me ask you a question. Do you think that you have an hour a day? Or let me ask you a question. What if I could show you how to be successful with your spare time? Or let me ask you a question. What if I showed you a way to make an income in 5 hours a week? Would you be interested? Something like that. Because what that does is it gives you the opportunity to find out if that's really what's holding them back. Because if it is, and you said to me, you can show me how to be successful with just an hour a day, well, yeah, let's talk. Right? If that was really what was holding me back, I'd be like, yeah, let's talk. If that wasn't what's really holding me back, what would I do? Give you another objection. Yeah, but I don't really know enough people. So then what do? I go, glad you brought that up. I understand. But let me say this. What if I told you that to be successful, you really only have to find three people who have like minds, or you really only have to find three people who think the way you think, or would like more money, or want to look better, or whatever. If that was really what was holding me back, what would I do? I'd say, oh, a few people. I know probably at least 20 people. Oh, okay, we talk. Or if it wasn't what was holding me back, what would I do? Yeah, but I really don't have the $500 either. And then I'd say, thank you for your honest response. You just keep going through this until you get to the root of it. You guys, this is big stuff. This is like, if you can master this, your recruiting will go through the roof, I promise you. The third step is to move forward. So it's validate, neutralize, and move forward. Moving forward is your power statement, like this. Listen, at the end of the day, you get to decide whether or not this is a right opportunity for you, but at least you'll know how you can work it around your busy schedule. Or at the end of the day, you get to decide whether or not this is a good fit for you, but at least you'll know how you can be successful without knowing everybody in your town. Or at the end of the day, you get to decide whether or not this is something you want to pull the trigger on, but at least you'll know how you can be successful without having great sales skills. So let me put it together for you like this. Oh gosh, that sounds like a great program, Sarah, but I'm not a salesperson. I would say, oh my gosh, thank you for bringing that up. I'm glad you said that, actually. I hear that all the time. What would it mean to you if I said, we're not looking for salespeople, actually. We're looking for real people. You know what? At the end of the day, you get to decide whether or not this is a good fit for you, but if you want to watch like a 15-minute video, at least you'll understand how you can be successful without having to be a salesperson. So seriously, what am I going to do? If that's really what's holding me back, I'm going to be like, okay, I'll watch the video. Because I'd like to do it if I just don't feel confident in my sales skills. But if that's not what's really holding you back, I'm going to give you another objection, and another objection, and another objection. And then you realize you're barking up the wrong tree. Right? But when you give people the out, you're going to get the truth. When you people don't feel comfortable telling you the truth, you're going to get lip service. Right? Oh, sure, I'll do it. Oh, sure, I'll watch the video. No intention of watching the video. Oh, sure, I'll show up for the meeting. No intention of coming to the meeting. Because they don't want to disappoint you. They don't want that reaction from you. That they're, whatever it is, anger, disappointment, whatever. Right? But if your posture is like, dude, take it or leave it, babe. But I'm not going to let you say no so you know what you're saying no to. I care enough about you to give you the information in a way that's going to resonate with you. Okay, so give me an objection.
$500.
What's that?
Don't have the $500.
I don't have the $500. Okay, we hear that all the time, right? Yeah. Oh, sounds like great. I don't have the $500. Great. So what would I say? Thank you for your honest response. Thanks for bringing that up. Thank you for sharing that with me. I appreciate your honesty about that. I get it. When I started, I didn't have $500 either. But if I were to show you how you could make that $500 back within 30 days, it's something that you'd be interested in. But you know what? At the end of the day, whether or not this is for you is certainly up to you. But I hate to let the $500 be what gets in the way of you never having to say that again. Or if you want to come to a meeting and spend an hour and learn how you could make that $500 back really quickly, I'd love that opportunity to share it with you. What's another objection?
I'm not a good salesperson.
Okay, I'm not a good salesperson, right? What do you say? Thank you for your honesty. Thank you for bringing it up. Thank you for your honesty. Whatever it is, I don't care what the objection it is. Thank you for bringing that up. Thank you for your honest opinion. Thank you for that honest feedback. Thank you for the response.
I'm so glad you said that.
I'm so glad you said that. Thank you for bringing that up. Right? And then you might ask, yeah, I hear that all the time. If I had a dime for every time someone said they weren't a salesperson as they're walking across the stage to get their $50,000 check, right? Whatever it is, thank you for bringing that up. I get where you're at. I hear you. However, for example, I'll use a different way of saying that. Thank you for bringing that up. Thank you for your honest response to that. Listen, what if I told you that we're not looking for salespeople? We're looking for real people who can get excited about a product. Or what if I told you that the most successful people in the company have never had any sales experience? Is it something you want to look into? Because at the end of the day, you get to decide whether or not it's a good fit. But I'd love to give you the information so you can make an educated decision. You see, there's no urgency in my voice. Like, I'm not like... Right? No. It's like, dude, if you want it, it's there for you. If you don't want it, that's okay. But don't pass it by because you have that information. Or don't pass it by because you don't have enough information. Okay? So now that all of the objections, they all work the same way. And I probably use this 10 times a week. Every time somebody sends me a text, Sarah, this is the response I got from my grand partner. They broke out. Or, you know, it's always the same. Thank you for your honest response. Thank you for sending me that picture. I understand your concern. However, you know, and you move through the steps. Validate, neutralize, move forward. Now, some of you might be thinking, okay, what if they say, I'm not a good salesperson, we kind of go, and then, oh, I don't have the money, and then I don't know other people. Then you get to the point where you're like, do I do this or not, right?
Yeah.
Kind of where you're at. So the fail-safe question that I always ask to find out kind of where we're at on the scale, if we've gone through a couple of objections, is this. On a scale of 1 to 10, where would you rate your interest in pursuing a closer look at this? And I never use the word doing this or signing up or becoming a rampart. I always say taking a closer look at this or taking a harder look at this or whatever, because there's less commitment there. Just a psychological thing.
Would you say that again?
On a scale of 1 to 10, where would you rate your interest in taking a harder look at this? And when you say it like that, then they're going to be more comfortable to tell you the truth, and they're going to say, you know what, Sarah, I appreciate it, but I really like it too. Cool. Or they might say, you know what, I'm a 7, I just got to figure out how to get that 500 bucks. Perfect. But it gives them the opportunity to tell you what's really going on with them versus me guessing or taking everything that they say at face value. Because people don't want to hurt you. They don't want to offend you. They don't want you to know that they don't have the $500. They don't want you to know that they're scared about their sales skills. They don't want you to know that they're afraid to talk to people. Right? So it's easier to just say no and not have to deal with it than have to own that and work through it. Especially if you don't have a really good rapport yet because you just met them. Does that make sense? Okay, so on a scale of 1 to 10, where would you rate your interest? And you might even take it a little further if you want to. Are you like at a 2, like seriously, Sarah, stop talking to me? Or are you like, yeah, no, I'm going to date. I just got to figure out how to make it work financially. You can walk them through that if you want to. Or just keep it at, on a scale of 1 to 10, where would you rate your interest at taking a harder look at this? And then you'll know. But the worst thing you can do is try to solve a problem that's not really the problem. Right? Taking it back to anything. Taking it back to working out. Like, I could have 10 excuses why I didn't make it to the gym, right? I was too busy. I was too tired. I had a flat tire. I didn't want it. The macaroni was going to get cold. Right? But what, at the end of all of that, at the end of all of those excuses, what really is it? I didn't want to bad enough, did I? Because I would have gone. If it was important enough to me, I would have done it. It's the same thing with our business. All these excuses don't mean anything. What it really means is, it's not that important to me, or I'm not at a yes yet. Why not? Because I don't have enough information. Or I don't like you. Yet. True. True. Or you're not doing this right. Right? So if you can just keep them in that maybe phase till they feel comfortable to give you a yes, you're much more likely to get a yes than when you try to rush them through the process and then you get a no and then you're like, oh, they said no, they don't have money, so I guess keep out. Yeah. If you can spend a little bit more time there and really unpack that a little bit, you're going to have much better results with your recruiting, I promise you. I promise you. Okay? Anybody have questions about that?
How many objections do you go through before you would ask that question?
She said, how many objections would you go through before you ask the question? I just do. What's wrong with you? Okay. I don't know, 2 or 3. But it happens. I think if you start incorporating this system into your recruiting, you're going to find that almost every time you hear a no, it was just a smoke screen. Mm-hmm. Almost every time. Because really the truth is, most people, if you really presented it like a golden ticket, and you really believe that they were going to, you know, be successful if they did A, B, C, D, repeat, they do it. The problem is they don't have the belief yet because they have had bad information or they don't have enough information because they know somebody, right? Their neighbor has a garage full of inventory and racked up credit cards and is getting divorced because they joined network marketing. Right? True. So they're like, oh, when you say network marketing, all of a sudden they're like, I don't want a garage full of inventory. I don't want racked up credit cards. I don't want to get divorced. You guys, that's what's happening, right? Because if they really knew that they could come in, give it an hour a day, you know, share a great art that everybody loves and be part of a billion-dollar run and all the great things with Jeff Olson and, you know, St. Louis and everything that we do, most people would be like, sign me up. But that's not what they're thinking. They're replaying old things that happened to them when they tried to sell jewelry 6 years ago. You know, but that's true. And that's what they think. And as soon as you say anything about MLM or whatever, they're like, nope, 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 nope. So true. Okay.
So we all have those notes. At what point do you keep circling back? Like, especially if we kind of said, okay, I heard no, and now I'm back and away. Would you go back to them again and do that whole process and say, I know at one point this is what your answer was. If I show you this, then what?
Okay, great question. She said, do you go back to people that you heard no from? Like, do you go back and visit them? Okay, a couple things. First of all, statistically, people's situation changes every 90 days. Every 90 days, people's situations change. So if you have a lead that you're working on, you should be revisiting them every 90 days. Because guess what? The brakes went out. They lost their job. The kids, you know, are now in school. Whatever was stressing them out at the time is no longer stressing them out, or whatever it is, it's a better time to revisit them. So in general, 90 days is a good time to revisit someone. And it might just be like, hey, guess what? Just wanted to touch base with you, let you know. We came out with a new product. I'm really excited, you know, to give you some info if you'd like it. Or, hey, guess what? We're opening a new country. I just announced we're going to be in Japan. Don't know if you know anybody there, but, you know, we'd love to chat with you briefly about that. Or something like that. So every 90 days, Nerium usually gives you a reason to call. Right? Okay. That being said, if it were me and I heard this training and I was like, first of all, brilliant. If I heard this training, I would be like, okay, who do I know that somebody that gave me one of those objections that I didn't handle it very well, what would I do? I go back to them and I call them up and I say, hey, listen, first of all, I have to apologize. I know that we chatted about Nerium and this was your concern, and I didn't really know how to handle that. I didn't really know how to walk you through that. You know, would you like to spend 10 minutes and revisit that with me? Or is that still something that's concerning you? It's okay to eat a little crow, to let people know that you're growing, let people know that you didn't handle something correctly. I do that all the time. Soccer. My son's been on the same soccer team for 3 years. Ask me how many of the moms know that I saw Nerium.
None.
One. Right? And that's because I usually don't get out of my car. I don't like to be cold. I don't watch the games and year-round game. It's always raining, snowing, and cold. I don't mean for the games. I watch the games for practice. No. All the other moms are, you know, chatting. I don't drink coffee. They're drinking coffee, doing whatever they do, and I'm in my car, you know, on Facebook or something. So after a couple of years, how hard is it for me to go back to those moms and be like, hey, guess what? I saw Nerium. So, sorry I haven't talked to you in 2 years. I'm the mom that did my son, 99, you know, right? So after a training several months ago, I thought I have to expose the moms to Nerium, right? I have to do it in a way that, you know, I feel good about. So I asked the teen mom for all of their emails, and there's like 17 kids, and I sent an email, and I apologized. I said, you know, I have to apologize. I know Carter's been playing with you guys for a long time, and I haven't really spent any time outside of the car. But I would love the opportunity to give you guys some of my product so that you could try it and give me some feedback. And I just kind of did it because I didn't want to just go hand out 17 bottles, right? Yeah. To people that I didn't know. I thought, okay, maybe the people that respond to me that actually, you know, are interested in it, then maybe I would give them a bottle. That was my plan, right? So I sent out the email. You know, it was really nice and whatever. Guess how many people responded?
Zero.
No, one.
Oh, one.
Come on, I'm not a total failure, you guys. The one who I already know. The one. Who's my friend? He responded. He's like, oh, sure, I'll try it, Tara. Thanks, Andrea. Yeah. Okay, right? What did that teach me?
I have to
build a rapport. So guess what I had to do?
Get out of the car.
Well, actually, my first goal was to learn the kids' names on the team, and then I was going to try to like match up the parents. And you know, again, this is still a work in progress, right? But luckily, it's a year-round sport, so I got time. But it's, what it taught me was that, no, you know, they're not going to respond to an email from somebody that they don't know that's been sitting in their car for the last couple of years. I've got to get out of the car and start building rapport and start, you know, talking to them about things that have nothing to do with Nerium. And I know that the next time that I go and offer that, or the next time, you know, the little conversations are going to be much more receptive to what I do. Mm-hmm. Same thing with my house. I just moved into a condo in a development. And first of all, it's like living with 50 Mrs. Kravitzes. So I was like, oh, there you go. I told you, going off late last night. But the good news is, and they also spot my daughter, so every once in a while I get a phone call. So your daughter just got home. It's like 2:30 in the morning. You might want to talk to her about that, Sarah. So I'm like, great. I'm in a neighborhood with all these old ladies that need Nerium, right? But I don't come out to my so my big plan in the summer was like, I'm going to do a market, or what's it called, RFP. I'm going to do an RFP. I'm going to invite all my neighbors. They're all going to come. They're going to fall in love with me, and they're going to fall in love with my product, and I'm going to have all these new customers. Except, I don't know any of them. I don't come out of my house. So I thought, I'm just going to, I can't even tell you guys, as long as being real. Okay. So I put up a fire on the mailbox. Yeah. Before and after pictures. Come see Ethan, your neighbor. Have some mimosas. And, right. Check out our name, this great anti-aging product, whatever. Put them up on the mailboxes. Because I don't even know who lives in what unit. I don't know which ones are empty, which ones have people. Unless they have, like, flower pots and stuff that I can figure out. Guess how many people came?
One.
Zero.
Zero.
More wine for you.
Yeah. Zero people showed up to my open house. So then I was like, okay. Well, I make up some goodie bags, like, with product in it, some information. I could take them to the houses that have flower pots and things like that, right? Success from Home magazine, a bottle of Nerium AD, a little thing, a little flyer, my name, my info. I go late at night when I know they're not going to answer the door. Hang them on the little thing. I found five people that I knew there was somebody that lived there, and put it there, right? How many customers did I get? Zero. Except for Christy, who is the HOA president, was like, Sarah, we can't do that. So I guess I have to come up with plan E about how to get customers in my neighborhood. But my point is that it keeps teaching me the same lesson, you think I've learned it, that you have to build rapport with people. People like you, and then they end up buying Nerium as a result of their connection to you. You can't fast forward. You can't take them from the no to the yes without getting them to the maybe where they're able to absorb the information. So don't be like Sarah. Get out of your car. Get out of your house. Meet people. Build rapport. And then you'll be able to paint the customers.
Well, one of the past regionals, you brought up the idea for somebody who knew that you were in Nerium already and how to go back to them, like someone saying, should you follow up with a note? I thought it was great what you said before is about, I'm in Nerium, but that was your way of going into the next part. You weren't interested the last time, but, and you come back with some new information. Mm-hmm. I just thought that was really good.
Thank you. Yeah, for whatever reason, things change, right? Like, I know last time we chatted, you weren't really good at it. However, now we have EHT. Now we have a brain supplement that supports everybody. Or I know you weren't, you didn't have a lot of time last time we chatted, but whatever it is, right? Always validate them and let them know that you hear them. Now, conversely, I'm going to tell you a success story now because I just failed in front of you like four times. So I want to bring it back to the second one again. How many of you guys are going to be in IGRO? Okay. I don't know what ROI is. Business network stuff. Okay. So I'm going to be an IGRO. Probably the best thing I've done for my business, and I encourage you to do something like that. Anyway, in BNI,
you'll be a what?
BNI.
Business Network
International. They have chapters all over the world. It's the oldest networking group on the planet. It's very serious. It's very regimented. They track all your referrals. It's a big deal. Okay. It costs money to get into it. You have to be accepted. It's not just like showing up at a chamber of commerce type thing. Okay. So, anyway, the purpose of BNI, you build rapport with the people in your group, and then they give you their referral business, and you give them their referral business, your referral business, right? So we have a painter, we have a realtor, we have an investment banker, different things like that. So if I ever hear of somebody that wants to sell a house, I'm like, oh, I know a guy might be in IGRO, you should check him out. Or if somebody needs their house painted, oh, I know a guy in BNI, you should check him out, you see? And they do the same thing with me. But you're building rapport. You have to go to a meeting every single week. You have to be there, and you get to know you. And you give a one-minute commercial every week, and then in a rotation, you get to give an eight-minute presentation about your business. Okay? Every single person in my BNI group is a customer. Mm-hmm. Every single person? Why? Because they like me now, right? Because they got to know me.
Could I please hear what
the
commercial is?
Yeah.
I'm really interested.
Okay, so every week we don't even need these slides. Okay. Every week you're allowed 1 minute to talk about your business, and you can kind of say whatever you want to say. Well, I find it a little bit difficult to do that because I don't have that much to say, right? We have four products, right? So it's like the same thing every time. So I try to mix it up a little bit. Like for Valentine's Day, I was like, nothing says I love you like firm treatment for your if you're ready, some firm. Yeah. So for example, I might have the point is to try to ask for a specific referral. Like, who are you looking for? What's a good referral for you? Right? So I'll talk about one product and I'll say a good referral for me is this. So for example, I might say, I'm really excited because we just launched EHT. It's a really powerful supplement for it to support overall brain health, and it helps with, you know, memory, it helps with muscle recovery, it helps with sleep, whatever. So an ideal referral for me would be somebody that suffers from any kind of brain injury. If you know anybody that's had head trauma, concussions, or whatever, and they just don't think quite the way they used to, or they're starting to notice that, you know, things are a little bit fuzzy for them, refer them to me, because I'd love to give them an opportunity to get some information and check out our 30-day supply of our EHT, something like that. Or, you know, we have a great product, firming treatment for the skin, so you put it on your body every single day, and it's going to help with loose skin, aging skin, cellulite, things like that. So an ideal referral for me would be somebody that's getting into fitness right now. I know that's the beginning of the year, everybody has fitness goals, so if you know somebody that's like always complaining about one little area that they can't get from the gym, or that sagging skin because they lost some weight, or something like that, then they'd be a great candidate to try my Nerium firm, something like that. Does that make sense? So just quick.
I'm stressed about that every week.
Oh, you do? Yeah. Okay.
And we have 20 seconds.
20 seconds. We only have a 25 member, so. But the point of this BNI story, first of all, it's a good tip to get into something like that. But also, it shows me that when you build rapport with someone and they get to know you, they're much more likely to check out what you have to offer. Wouldn't that be true for you?
Yeah.
Right. Think about all the people that you do business with. Right. People that you get your hair cut from, people you get your nails done from, people that mow your grass, people who do your taxes or whatever. If you got to know them first, and then you found out that, you know, they're an accountant or whatever, you'd be like, oh my gosh, I should totally have to do my taxes. Right? That kind of thing. All right. We're so far off the mark here. What a time is it? Oh, okay. Okay. Did I already talk about this?
Nope.
Okay. So, in this, when you're recruiting, you also have to figure out what motivates people. Right? Not everybody's motivated by money, would you agree? Some people are like, you know, I got enough money. Or money's not important to me. So what money does is it brings you choices and ways to support the rest of what you have going on, right? So you can, in your conversations, when you're getting to know people, these are some of the things that you're going to be looking at. What's important to them? Find out about their family. Do they have kids? Are they married? Are they struggling in that area? Do they live close to their family? Would they like to fly to go visit mom in Virginia? You know, what kinds of things kind of come up around the whole family thing? Do they have a child in college? Do they have a child in sports? You know, what kinds of things do they like to do with their husband? Are they looking for a husband? I did that at my DNI group. I was like, a perfect referral for me would be like 5'10" to 6'2". Something that lights them up, or they're like, oh my gosh, if I have to go back there one more time, I'm going to shoot myself in the face. You know, you're going to be able to tell really quickly when you ask somebody what they do, if they like their job or not, right? Is it something that they're excited about, that they want more of, that they want to share with you, or they're like, oh my gosh, I work at the bank. You know, every day, same thing. I go back to the bank again. I'll never forget going to the drive-thru one time and asked the drive-thru lady how she was doing, and her response to me is, I'll be doing fine in 10 more minutes. I'm like, wow, that's a nice thing to say to the customer. Right? That's how people feel sometimes about their jobs, right? So you'll get to know what lights them up about their job. Recreation, what do they like to do? What's the common habit? You like to ski? What do you do in the summertime when you're vacationing? Where do you vacation? What kinds of, you know, are they into arts and crafts? You know, are they into glass blowing? Are they into roller derby? Do they like to gamble? Whatever it is, right? Figure out what their occupation or their recreations are and then what motivates them. Because I think you're going to find clearly it's one of those things. Right? And then you can build that bridge and show them how Nerium, the opportunity within Nerium, can support those things. And then what it is it's making it about them. It's making them see themselves in the situation. They don't care about how much money you make or how successful you are or what your life looks like. They want to see themselves there, right? What their life could look like, how much money they could make, what this difference they could make for them. Right? And the only way to know is to build that rapport. Get to know them. Steps, you know, exposures 1 through 4. Who are you? What lights you up? Then steps 5 through 8. Let's talk about hearing and how that can support that. Whatever. Okay. There's a really simple system that we do, you guys all know this. The first thing is to peak interest, right? How do you peak interest? What's the number one way to peak interest? What? Before and after pictures. A great way to peak interest, right? How many times I sat on a plane with my iPad and I'm doing this with before and after pictures, waiting for the person next to me to ask me something? It's like 5 minutes goes by and Kristen is like, seriously, like. And then and finally, oh, what's that? What do you keep looking at? What are you doing? Right? Oh, this? Oh, it's before and after, right? Before and after pictures are a great way to peak interest. Facebook, right? When you put something up on Facebook, first of all, you want to do it in a time frame that people are going to be watching. Are you making your post at 3 o'clock in the morning? Are you going to get as much action as if you posted at 10 o'clock in the morning or 6 o'clock at night? Right, so think about that. Second of all, people don't want to read 3 paragraphs of stuff, do they? They want to glance at the photo. So if you just put up a picture on a Facebook, a before and after picture with a message that says, I just got in a new shipment of bottles, the first 3 people get it, you know, want to try it, give me a call. Or, I'm so excited to be sharing this picture of my friend with you, these are her 30-day results, message me for a free sample. Something like that. Simple, simple, simple. The pictures can do all the work for you, right? Now, more than half people won't respond at all, right? They won't like it. They won't comment on it. They won't message you. You might get a few messages here and there. You do it again, and again, and again, and pretty soon you're going to start getting those people that go, okay, fine. I've been watching your post for 3 months. Let's have it. Let's have your little wonder cream, right? It's true. But you got to keep doing it because while you're posting on Facebook, they're also hearing about it at the bus stop and the water cooler and someone else they know just signed up and other things are going on that's triggering them about Nerium. And when they finally decide that they want to try it or check it out or look at the business, you want them to come back to you. If you only make a post once every couple weeks, people don't think you're serious about your business. Then you're going to start hearing things like, didn't you used to sell that stuff, right? Are you still doing that thing? You don't ever want your prospects to be like, are you still doing that thing? You want people to go, this person's serious because they want to follow somebody who has their head in their business, right? So Facebook is a great way to expose people because it doesn't cost any money, it's quick, and it's effective. And I don't care if it takes 6 months for somebody to respond. They are watching. They are paying attention. Think about your own life and what you put on Facebook. How many times have you had somebody talk to you about, they maybe haven't seen forever, you've seen at the grocery store or seen a meeting, and they're like, oh my gosh, how was Hawaii? And you're like, I think I was Hawaii. Right? They saw it on Facebook 3 weeks ago. They're paying attention. Okay, so your hearing business can be very visible there versus if you're not using that as a tool. If you're not getting a lot of action, then go friend a bunch of people. Build your what is it?
No.
Yeah. Okay. Same thing with Instagram or any LinkedIn, any of those things. The point is to be consistent with it and be short and sweet and make sure, and also don't share other people's things, repost it. If somebody shared, makes something good, copy it and post it versus sharing it. Because people don't read a share the same way they read your post. Right? When you're posting things, tag other people. Take your team. So that it goes on your wall and your friends see it, and it goes on their wall and their friends see it, and so on. Or your customers. One of my things that I've been working on and that has been done well for me is those EHT testimonials. Yes. So you give somebody a bottle, ask them to, or a box, ask them for their testimonial, write it up, make a little Facebook thing, and post it. thanks so much, Tim, for agreeing to try this product, and God's working out for you, and I put his customer website on it. I know your friends are going to want it, too. Help your team get their three for free. Another thing that you can do is those little videos, and I know these kids are on the videos, but why don't you go up to some of your customers that have had good results, or somebody that's excited about the product, and ask them for a 30-second testimonial and just videotape it with their phone and post it. Post it on your wall. Post it on their wall. Help them get their product for free. Because if their friends start seeing that, they're going to be like, hey, Martha, why didn't you tell me about that stuff? What's the deal? They're going to start getting comments. You're going to see it because you're tagged in it, and then you have new prospects. Right? Just a 30-second little, tell me what you like most about Nerium, or tell me what you've experienced with EHT. Okay, put their picture by it, put their information by it, so it makes it real and credible. Right? But those things are really powerful for you, and they don't cost you anything, and they don't take any time. Okay? What's another way to expose somebody? The bottle, magazines and bottles. Every time a bottle goes out, a magazine should go with it, or something that tells a story for you, right? And maybe a little flyer or something that tells you how to use the product. Okay? But if you're getting people, first of all, you have bottles, you've got your new gift back bottles, you got your bottles from your kit, whatever, those need to be going out to people to try. That's a huge seller for you. Somebody who's not interested in a cream, somebody who says, I'm using a cream. Right? I don't need your little cream. I don't need anything as is. I'm good. I got this on lock. Don't need your cream. Right? You give them a bottle of pie for free, they're going to do that for you as a favor because they like you, then they might be surprised by the results they get. Right? And all you're asking for is their feedback. If they don't like it, it's cool. You just appreciate them taking the time to try it. Right? So your bottle's a great tool for you. Magazines, bottles, Facebook, videos, any tools, right? So you're piquing their interest, you're giving them something. Something to look at, something to do, something to try, something to smell, whatever. And then you're giving them the magazine, the video, or something with it. Okay? That's just piquing their interest. If they watch the video or they read the magazine, you're golden. How many of you guys give videos out and just never get open? Most of them, right? Most of them. So you're only looking for a few people to actually check it out. But you've got to give it to 100 to get 20 people to open it. And out of the 20 people that open it, you might get 5 people that go to the next step, right? Which is show up to something like this at market party or whatever, and then you maybe get one person that actually becomes a brand partner. But what happens to most of us is we take interest with 10 people, and we get 2 people to open it. And then we get one person to show up to a market party, and we decide not to sign up. And then what? We feel like we failed. We got to quit. I knew this was a pyramid scheme. I'm going back to Starbucks. I want to work 40 hours a week. This is, I'm not good at this. I'm not a salesperson. That girl, the blonde, the leather, liar. So, peak interest, third party tool, three-way calls. I think three-way calls is what we're talking about next. How many of you guys use a third party? Okay, we should have more hands than that. I know that this is kind of intimidating, and I know it can be a little bit awkward. The easiest way to avoid that is to keep it so simple and casual. Okay, so a third party, first of all, what's a good candidate for a third party? Somebody who's already been exposed to a tool. Somebody who's already watched a video, came to a meeting, tried the bottle, read the magazine, something like that. I don't mean somebody that you sent a video to. I mean somebody who watched a video. Okay, don't get on the phone for a three-way call when you say, I sent them the video, did they watch it? Uh-uh. Oh, great. So what are we going to talk about? The Simpsons? I mean, we need to make sure that they have an idea of what's going on before we go into a third-party call, right? Okay. So somebody who's, you piqued their interest, you built rapport, they've agreed to take on some information, so now they're in the maybe phase, they actually took the time to watch the video or whatever it was, now it's time for a third-party call. So when you follow up with that person, hey, I want to follow up with you to see what you thought about that video, what was the best thing about what you saw? Or hey, I just wanted to follow up with you about the magazine I left for you, what was your favorite thing about what you read? And by the way, it's really cool to take those, you guys have those little Nerium tabs or any tabs, but the little, and earmark something on your magazine that you think that prospect would be interested in. Okay, instead of just handing them the magazine, say, read this, say, read this. This is the part about BHT. This is the part about Anna Woodward. This is the part about whatever, something that will resonate with that person, right? Because they might not want to pick up the magazine and read the whole thing, but they're more likely to read the page that you think is most beneficial to that, right? Okay, so after they've taken the time to actually look at the tool, and you call them back and find out what they thought, what they liked best or whatever, I don't care what they like, what their reaction is, it's time for a three-way call. So, whatever it is, oh, I see that, you know, you guys have a Lexus program, that's pretty cool. Oh my gosh, isn't that cool? Like, getting to drive a brand new car, not having to pay for it, is pretty awesome. I'm going to see if I can grab my friend Sarah on the phone with us real quick. She earned her Lexus pretty quickly, and I'd love for you to hear her story. Hold on one second. Right? Or, wow, I see that you guys have a brain supplement right now. How does that work? That's a really great question. I'm super excited about BHT, but I'm kind of new at this, and I know I'm going to forget to tell you something. What are you doing? Let me grab my friend Sarah on the phone with us real quick and see if we can ask her that question together. She's super fun. Boy, is she fun. You're really lucky. If we get her, you're going to remember this day for a long time. Let me grab my friend Sarah. Let me grab my friend Bill. Let me grab my friend Lori. Let me grab my friend Doc. It's not, let me see if I can get my super awesome upline to close the deal with you, so you better have your credit cards ready. That's not it. Let me grab my friend Sarah. You see that language is very casual. You see if I can grab her. Not she's on standby. I've talked to her about you for 2 weeks. I can't believe you're finally going to do this call. Hear her story, or let's ask her that question together, or let's see if we can come up with that together. Okay? Then you're going to, first of all, in the meantime, you let me know, or your upline, whoever's doing a three-way call for you, that you're going to be trying to do a three-way call. And I don't know if other leaders in this room have the same experience as me, but I would say that probably 70% of my three-way calls never happen. You guys feel like that, you're on standby, and then they don't answer the phone, or something happens. Okay, so that happens. You're not always going to get every three-way call, but you are aware of it. I never had my ringer on, so I was like, well, text me 30 minutes before, so I turned my ringer on, you know, that kind of thing. And to me, that's also a way of saying, are we still on? Right? Are we still on? Because I'm not going to put every three-way call on my calendar. Are we still on? Okay, 30 minutes, right? So I already know you're going to call me. I already know a little bit of a background about this person. If you can give your expert a little bit of background about what's going on with this person, that helps. I know where they work, what they're into, what they were excited about, kind of a little bit about their story. I don't need 4 pages of how you've known, you know, all this time and everything, but just kind of where they're at right now, what tool they saw, that kind of a thing. Then if you're going to dial up you're going to put your prospect on hold. You always have the prospect on the phone first. Always have the prospect on the phone first. Put them on hold so you can grab your friend Sarah, right? You're going to call me. And you're going to remind me who we're talking to. Hey, Sarah, it's Lori. Okay, so I've got Mary on the line. Remember, she's the one I told you that watched the video. She's really excited. She has no car right now. She really wants a Lexus. You are going to tell her about your story and focus on the Lexus. I'm going to go, okay, got it. Then you're going to merge the calls together after you've debriefed me about who we're talking to. And you're going to reintroduce us. Okay, are you there? Yep, okay. All right. Mary, this is my friend Sarah that I told you about. I'm super stoked that we got her on the phone. Remember I told you how awesome she was? Okay, I'm going to be saying that. She's pretty successful in the company. She's been doing this for a couple of years. She earned her Lexus really quickly, and I wanted you to hear her story. You can ask her any questions about exactly how that Lexus program works. Sarah, this is my friend Mary. Remember I told you about her. She's really excited. She doesn't have a car right now. She's looking to see if this Nerium thing might be a good fit for her and, you know, maybe help her get into a new car in the next couple of months. I'm going to mute myself out now so that you guys can chat. Thank you so much for your time, both of you, okay? And then you're going to put yourself on mute. There's nothing worse than being on a three-way call when the person interrupts or starts adding things in the middle of the call. Because it takes away the train of thought, it kind of devalues the expert, and it ruins a little bit. Okay, so you have to mute yourself out. And then you're going to let the expert and the prospect talk. The expert's going to share their story, whatever, ask the questions, that kind of thing, okay? When that's done, Then you come back on the line and you thank them both for their time again, and the call is over. You hang up. You don't stay on the line with the prospect. Okay? Don't undo what we just did. If you can call them back in a half an hour, call them back in half an hour, but that call is done. Thank you so much for your time. It's great talking to Mary. I'll follow up with you tomorrow, or Mary, I'll follow up with you tonight, or whatever it is. Done. Okay? That's how you do a three-way call. You've already let the expert know that you're going to be calling. You call the prospect first. Whatever question they have, whatever interests them, that's a great question. Let me see if I can grab my friend Sarah, and we'll ask her that together. Or let me see if we can grab my friend Sarah so she can tell you her story about that. You put that person on hold. You call me. You remind me who I'm talking to. You merge the calls, introduce us, mute yourself out, let us chat, thank us for coming. Hang on. Okay? It gets a little weird when you make it weird. Don't make it weird. That's a great question. Let me grab my friend Sarah, see if I can get her real quick. Casual. Okay? Does that make sense? All right. It's very, very, very effective because guess what? Your prospect has a relationship with you on some level. Right? Maybe they're not comfortable telling you the truth. Maybe they don't want to tell you about their financial problems. Maybe they don't want to ask the stupid question to you. But they don't have a connection to me. I'm not vested in whether or not they join the company or not. They don't have to impress me. They don't have to do anything. Right? I'm just giving the information. Okay, so it's different. You're going to have a more authentic conversation that way. Plus, it gives a little validity. Maybe your friend knows that, quite honestly, you haven't been doing anything with your business. Let's be real, right? Like, I want to make a bunch of money. I know you're not making a bunch of money. I want to talk to somebody who's making a bunch of money. Or, I know that you've been doing this for a while and you don't have your Lexus. I want to talk to someone who has their Lexus. It just brings a little bit more validity to what we do. Okay? Any questions about that? All right, we're going to take a break in just a second. Oh, look. Yep, okay. So, we're going to take a break. We're going to do recognition when we come back, and then we're going to talk about the RRP. And then we're going to be up. So, let's see how much of a break do we take?
We're not
taking a break.
I think we're going to do something.
Okay, we're going to do something.